Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Hagit Messer-Yaron. You can see my name here. And I'm honored to chair this panel on identification and promotion of engineering excellence. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for inviting me. In this panel, we have four panelists. Professor Gadi Golan. Gadi, raise your hand. Gadi is the president of the Holon Institute of Technology. He has now some story about him, but this is not the scope of this meeting. Dr. Jonathan Friedman, Jonathan, right here. I put him as an entrepreneur and former CEO of Provigent. He will present himself probably with different emphases, but I tell you a secret. Jonathan got his PhD under my supervision like 10 years ago. Shlomi Dolev, another professor right there. Shlomi is from Ben-Gurion University in the Negev. He is now the dean of Faculty of Natural Sciences. And Tzvi Meiri, Tzvi is here. Tzvi is also a professor. Tzvi is the head of the newly established Electric and Electronics Department at the Ort Hertmann Academic College in Netanya. Each one of them will present his view of identification and promotion of engineering excellence, and then we let some question or discussion as long as the time permits. Let me start with a short introduction regarding data about engineers and mainly electrical engineering. I didn't present myself. I'm also a professor of electrical engineering at Tel Aviv University. So naturally, I'm focused on electric and electronics engineers. Electrical and electronics engineers. Just to get a view of, I don't need it. You need it. Okay. The data from the Central Bureau of Statistics in Israel is updated to almost 3 years ago. And if you check back 3 years ago, there were 2,252 graduates in electrical engineering in Israel. This is grosso modo, meaning that there are people here from universities, from colleges, undergraduate and graduate degree, 30, only 30 PhDs at that year. And also, it's not only electrical engineering, also the combination of electrical and computer engineering with computer science, with physics, etc. It is interesting to see the distribution of this graduate from colleges and universities. And if you can see the small numbers, less than 50% of the graduates are from university, actually only 43%. The rest came from colleges. And in our panel, we have also leaders of engineering departments and institutions from colleges. So this is a different measure of engineering than the traditional universities. And my personal view is that only 10% out of these 2,252 were women. And I must say this number is not increasing. When I was an undergraduate student in engineering, like, I don't know, 2 years ago, maybe 30, almost 40 actually. Then we were also like 10% women. So there is not much of a change. I follow the data of the IEEE, the Institute for Electrical and Electronic Engineering, and altogether they have 415,000 members all over the world, and they're also about 10% of the members are women. Let's look at the evaluation of engineering and in electrical engineering in particular in Israel over the last 40 years. I'm not sure if you can follow the numbers, but if you look at the 1970 altogether, we had in all kind of engineering, including architectures, we had 4,000 graduates in engineering. Last year, or in 2009, there were almost 40,000, so it's 10,000. 10 times more. And if you look at the distribution over the years, I put it on this plot. Jonathan actually told me to use the Excel, right? So that's what came out of you teaching me. So you see the growth from 1970 to last year, which is, as I said, almost 10 times. But what is more interesting to see the split between universities and colleges. Universities, in the 1970, we had only universities, and the growth is almost linear, while the colleges, which accompanied in the mid-90s, they start here to contribute to the growth in the number of engineers in Israel. I believe it's not only the number, but also the characteristic of engineering education is a bit different in universities and in college. So we have the numbers. Let me just finish with some outlines for the discussion we are going to have later. I just put some bullets here, and you can, of course, relate to it or relate to other things. We are talking about identification and promotion of engineering excellence, and I put the following questions. For example, engineering excellence, is it actually measured by our ability to solve problems? Or is problem solving is not enough? I know the title of this conference is innovation, so problem solving is probably not enough. Are we talking about searchers or researchers? Are we also only going to use existing solutions and then look for them and maybe combine them together? Or should we also come up with new stuff? That's what I put under research, meaning it creates new knowledge and searching for existing knowledge. Are we looking for the best possible solution or only with solutions which are good enough for the customer or for the person or entity who invited a specific job? Should we provide a solution which is good enough, or should we look for the best possible solution? When we are talking about innovation, we are talking about the next generation technologies. Should it be evolution, meaning extrapolate the existing technology, or revolution? And if we are talking about revolution, how do we get it? Again, innovation, this is an important topic in this conference. So where does the innovation come from? You can say interdisciplinarity, you can say with some brilliant minds. We will hear you, our experienced panelists. And also the problem of LLL, which is the acronym from long life learning. As I said, it happened to be that most of the panelists are educators. We are from universities, colleges. But once we finish educating an engineer, he or she goes to have a career. What about 10, 20 years from the time they went out of school? So long life learning is an important issue in any topic, in engineering, especially under our dynamic environment. It is a key issue, and I realize we may also refer to this. So remember these questions. You can come up with other questions. I am happy to invite the panelists to speak one after the other, and as I said, we will open the floor afterwards. And I will start by the list here. Gadi, please, are you ready? You are the first speaker.
Well, shalom everybody. actually, when I was asked to take part in this conference, in this panel, I couldn't believe what will be the situation that I'm right now involved in. And but I'll try to divide my talk into two parts. So first of all, about the excellence in engineering. About a year ago, last October 2011, I was nominated to the president of an institute named Holon Institute of Technology. It's not a university, of course, you know, and I was nominated, and I was very proud, my mother as well, and I was very glad, and I believed, and actually my ticket, my charter was to raise this institute from actually quite a sleeping institute just a teaching institute into a real, I wouldn't say a university, but a teaching and researching institute. And this was my ticket, this was my charter. At that time, I tavati tabitui, how do you say? I made an expression. Okay. The expression, what I called the excellence in academics, in colleges. What I said is that excellence is not saying that I'm better than you, I'm excellent than you, and you are excellent than me, but excellence is the name of a process in which each academic staff must be excellent. Pay attention, not the student, but the academic staff. Excellence is the process of continuous improving your teaching capabilities and your researching capabilities. Always do it, always do it. Go asymptotically to the line of infinity, which never occurs. But this is the excellence. Excellence is the name of the process. And the belief was that if the teacher in a college is using this process of excellence, he'll inflict, he'll influence the students, because the students are coming and going, and nobody knows who is real our student. So if I'm excellent, my student will eat whatever he wants. If he can, he'll eat more. If no, no. So the whole institute should be excellent. And immediately there was another expression of Yazamut academic entrepreneurship. Academic entrepreneurship is, again, a new term in which the word entrepreneurship exists, but we don't mean entrepreneurship in the meaning of a startup, but academic entrepreneurship. So what we did, first of all, we mapped all our academic staff. It's about 120 academic staff. We found academic leaders, 10 or like about 10 academic leaders. What do we mean by leader? Leader is an academic staff that can stand and front the people and gather some academic staff around him. So we found the leaders. And then we made dean of academic entrepreneurship. It's a academic staff, Vered, her name, excellent girl. And she's pushing the groups. We made what we call research groups, and each research group with its leader started looking for proposals, raising money. There was spin-offs of each group was separated to many research groups, and each one is going for proposals, and much money came in, and it's not the money, but you could see the glare in the eyes of the academic staff. First time in history, they are not only teaching, they are doing research, they are getting money, they can get some money, extra money from this research, they can take higher students. All or each academic, each research group must include an industrial partner. So it's our academic, another academic, which could be also university, and industry. One, two, three should be in each group. And the story is excellent. Much money came in. Actually, it was 14 million shekels. And most of the academic staff started working. Of course, there are many people that cannot do anymore, but most of the people, the young people, or the people that are capable still, started working. And then I was fired. When the activity came to such an activity of research, I nominated this Vered, this dean of academic entrepreneurship, to a CEO of our tech transfer company. And tech transfer company is dealing with money. And when it comes to money, I was fired. And this is the idea what I'm telling you. I was super naive person.
Chagit is same like me, but Chagit is less naive because Chagit was much more experienced. But she comes also from academy. But she has a few more steps in her life which made her less naive. She was the chief scientist in the Ministry of Science, and she did several more positions which made her less naive. But for a naive person which is very proud of being a president, and his mother is super proud of him, I didn't realize the difference between colleges and universities. And now I'm fully aware. What is a college? A college like our college and all other colleges is actually a box, a big box, with 120 million shekels. It's a big box of money. That's it. It's a box of money controlled by some people, which are called the mosdot, the institutions, the Vad Menahel and Hever Nehmanim, people who are controlling money and lots of money. So these people can actually manage a university or a factory of dagim yubashim. How do you say? Whatever.
Dried fish.
The box is more important, the box. And as long as you are doing your job, make a research group and go to conferences and make these people work and they are arguing and nominate them and don't nominate them and let them fight with each other, it's all okay. Don't touch our box. Whenever you touch our box, you're fired. And this is the secret which I just studied on my skin. And that's it. When I only started asking, the process was done. It's a dirty process, nobody knows, they are hiding and blah, blah, blah. One day they come to you and say, "Pak, you're fired." I said, "Hey, why?" And now they bring the ilot, the pretexts, that you are doing too much research, and actually you are a college, and who asked you to make research? And I'm saying, hey, it's on my charter. The charter of the institute is doing research, excellence. And there, these people are signed on sikume diyun, on minutes of meetings, which are gomrim et ha-halel. Praise the activity and say chapeau. It never happened to our college. So many activities. Now we are involved in research. So many millions are coming in. 8 times until the 18th of June. In July, Vered is nominated to the CEO of the tech transfer, and Gadi is fired. And now Gadi is fired due to making research. And second accusation is that you're bringing so much money that we can't hold this money because it's too much. And this money also brings us matching money. And matching money can kill us. None of them understands really what is matching money. Matching is not out-of-pocket money. Matching is the money that is being paid as salaries. And that's it. There's two more. If you read the marker last week, another accusation was that Gadi goes barefoot, which is true. I'm always going barefoot because I can't think when I have shoes on my leg. So they said we wanted a more itzugi, more representative president. And the last one was that Gadi is going with a 1 shekel watch, and it's not representative. So I'm very proud. This is 1 shekel. Actually, it cost me $1. A black guy in New York, one time on a crossing, Mavar Chatzaya, he said, "Hey, man, do you want a watch?" So I gave him $1, and he gave me this watch. It was 15 years ago. And this watch is excellent, and I love this watch. $1 I paid. He probably stole it from I don't know where. So this is Gadi. I'm going barefoot. I'm going with a 1 shekel watch, and I'm doing research. And this is it, I'm fired. Now we're expecting, they're acting very fast, so maybe now I'm speaking on Tuesday is my shimua. How do you say shimua?
Hearing.
Is my hearing. Actually, this hearing is my gorali nechratz. But I hope it won't happen, because there are miracles. There are always believe in high forces. But actually, if you go to the conics on Tuesday, I'll be beheaded. They're going to cut my head. And actually, my ashmati, my fault, is doing research and bringing money to the colleges. I think now that the papers are now full with this story. And if they are not full now, tomorrow and in a day after, they will be full. And this brings again the question of colleges. You just saw yesterday what happened in Bar-Ilan University. Actually, quite the same story, but Bar-Ilan is a university and a big university, and it's not a college. Colleges grew up from zero. And when you grow up such an institute, when it doesn't grow as an academic institute, but as a 120 million shekel box of money, this is what's happening. And I'm sure that my case will be a cornerstone, even if I'll be beheaded, this story will have its echo all over the Israel. Not the universe, but at least Israel. Toda rabba.
Toda rabba, Gadi. Identification and promotion of engineering excellence. We didn't mean to focus on colleges and universities, but as I said in my introduction, the movement from educating engineers in universities only to colleges is a point where excellence is judged. So the next on the row is Dr. Jonathan Friedman. He has a presentation. Let's see if as an engineer we can open it. Yeah. Somebody close it, please.
Thank you very much. Well, my presentation will be a little less personal. So the story tells about Columbus. He was dining with Spanish nobles, and they were mocking him for his discovery of America. They were saying that was not such a big deal. You only navigated west. Anyone could have done that. You simply hit America, and you were lucky doing that. So Columbus responded by taking a whole leg and asking the noblemen whether one of them can have the egg stand on one of its ends. You can see in the pictures, the nobleman tried and tried to make the egg stand on one of its ends with no success. And Columbus took the egg, cracked it a little, and smashed it a little on the table and made it stand on the end, showing them that once the task is done, it always seems very easy to do it. But before that, it's not that simple. So with this thought in mind, I sought to talk a little about the difference between excellence and innovation. So the first question for me was, well, what exactly is excellence? And you take a look at the dictionary definition, you would find something of the outstanding quality or something like that. Well, since we're talking about engineering, I would rather look at a definition of my own, and that would be excellence would be effectively implementing tools or knowledge that we currently have. One example I very much like is building bridges. One bridge is never like another. You always have to implement new tools, calculate the amount of steel or anything you have to do on how to create such an immense project. Every project is different, but yet everybody in order to do it well, you have to implement existing tools. Now, when you start talking about innovation, you have to look at something else. It has to relate in some sort, I would say, to creativity, maybe some things which are a little out of the box. And for me, the definition of innovation would be instead the creation of new knowledge and new tools. So there's definitely a gray line between the two. While using one, you in excellence, you're adjusting tools, and whether that becomes a new tool or not, as there's always a gray level. But if you want to identify these things, so identifying excellence, I think it's relatively easy. You go, for example, while teaching in the academy, so you have, you're teaching some sort of course. In the final exam, you're giving questions, usually questions which are not ones answered throughout the course, but ones that you have to use the tools in that you have studied. Excellent students manage to do that. So identifying excellence is I would say, much easier. Identifying innovation would be a little harder. And also, I want to stick a little more about this definition. So you probably find many examples which do not comply with this definition. The social networks, ICQ, Mirabelle says ICQ, or clearly they were very innovative at their time, yet they're not even close to my definition. And I would say that they were more related to they were innovative in the sense that they identified a new need, and they are much less innovative from, I would say, an engineering perspective. So I'm fine with them not complying with my definition. Other questions we need to ask about is, should innovation be useful in some sense? That's a tough one. If someone finds a new galaxy, is that innovative? If historians go back and suddenly realize how Romans managed to move water from one place to another, would that be innovative? So to answer that, I would say there's a big problem in defining useful. What does useful mean? Does that mean it has to be profitable, or humanity has to gain something? Well, defining useful is probably even harder than defining innovation. So how do we identify innovation? So first thing I would say that if you look at the high-tech industry, the vast amount of it would not be, I would not say that they're innovative. They are much more related to excellence, much more related to doing new things with existing tools. So one way I would say to identify innovation is to have a history perspective. So when it's quite easy to understand that when Copernicus claimed that the sun does not revolve around the earth, that was very innovative. It was clearly counterintuitive to the thought at the time, and definitely against religion and all our ways of thought. But it's not enough to be to be counterintuitive to be innovative. You'd also have to be right, because there are many counterintuitive suggestions which are probably not that good. And history perspective allows us to check that out. The fact is that if you ask one out of five Americans, they're still not sure about that. but still, we'd like to have a way to identify innovation in real time and not just in history perspective. So one thought we can look at is patents. And why patents? Patents are a way, in order to approve patents, two of the most important criteria to approve a patent would be novelty and non-obviousness. So they seem like a good way to identify innovations. Still, I don't think it's going to be a hard claim to say that the vast amount of patents are non-innovative and probably do not have much to do with excellence either. You know, just Google a little, just a few examples of things which you can find in patents. You have this mirror to check your wax in your ear. You got a leash to take your pet snake outside, and other kissing condoms so that you're not going to be infected while you're kissing. However, I do think that although patents cannot serve as identification, the rules of approving patents are interesting in terms of looking at innovation. One very important rule when you're trying to approve a patent is long-felt need. Now, when you're trying to approve your examiner checks your patent and tells you you're obvious and there's nothing novel about that, if you manage to show him that you have managed to solve a problem which was long desired to be solved, then you're in good shape. So one example for that is ever since we've been kicked out of heaven, we've been had to do the work by ourselves. So throughout history, people tried to improve the way we do work. At first, we had to carry stones by ourselves. Later on, we learned to do to use natural forces or to make use of animals to help us in our work. And as years went by, we learned to use our work more effectively through wheels and lever. And of course, 300 years ago, the big invention of the steam engine, we found ways to have machines do the work for ourselves. So clearly, improving the way we do work is a long-felt need. And any steps that were made throughout the way, probably many, many people have been thinking about them, and it took many years to do that. So any step that was made can be claimed, can be identified as innovative. I think another interesting rule is to look at the measure of an engineer skilled in the art. So if you're working on, you have a solution to a problem and you want to identify whether it's innovative or not, you can do the simple thinking trick. What would happen if you would take a bunch of engineers skilled in your art? Would they be able to reach a solution similar to yours or as good as yours? And if the answer to that is no, then you've got something innovative. So to sum up, I would say that to identify innovations would have to have something which is different from excellence in the sense they would have to have something counterintuitive and with a little bit surprise in it. One short story about surprise, there was the famous lexicograph Samuel Johnson. He was the first guy who wrote, he wrote the first English dictionary, and he was very meticulous about his English. So his wife comes home, and she caught him with his housemaid. His wife tells him, "Oh my dear, you surprise me." And Samuel answered to her, "No, my dear, I am surprised, you are astonished." So I would say that innovations would have to have some sort of surprise and not a lot of astonishment. Thank you very much.
Another way to be innovative is to have students like Jonathan, right? The next in the panel is Shlomi Dolev. As I said, Shlomi is a professor and the dean of the Faculty of Natural Sciences at Ben Gurion University. So please.
I will start telling you about my experience at the Technion, which was starting at 1980. I started studying civil engineering. Well, there was some kind of business in the family that I thought that it will happen. But essentially, when I finished in the last year, I heard about computers and I said, why not taking some courses there? And and understanding what is a miracle. So I took two courses, and I remember that going to the first exam, I think it was in discrete math or data structures, I went to a colleague because my calculator didn't have batteries. And I went to some other student and asked him, he's this guy from computer science. I told him, I need your calculator for the exam. He said, we don't use calculators in the exam. I told him, you're a computer scientist, how come? He said, don't worry, you don't need a calculator there. I was used to calculate, you know, every beams, how the beam and structures and to have all these numbers. I go to the exam, it's only puzzles. It's a really different way of thinking. And this lesson took me during the rest of the studies. I really enjoyed knowing the difference between science and engineering, and I understood what is the potential to combine them. It's a great potential. I remember that one of the other student told me that the nuclear bomb that was created during the Second World War was just possible because an engineer came and took all the scientists together and make it work. They had the results, but there was need somebody that will be more practical to make it, you know, done. So to have these two skills of thinking, you know, freely and on science, and then to take it and do it, there are two different way of thinking. And this took me, and I saw it during many places new in the career. For instance, I had PhDs from computer science and also from electrical engineering, because their advisor went to a sabbatical. So he gave me these PhDs, continue advising them. So it's about some optics, how to use optics for calculations. And then I gave both PhDs a problem, please solve it. And the engineer will say, well, I can buy this here, I can buy the other stuff here, I can connect them, and here how I would do it. And the computer scientist will say, well, I need something that looks like this. You know, he just used imagination rather than, you know, trying to compose something that is on the shelf. And those two approaches are really needed. And at some, you know, occasion in the political life in the university, I had to deal with an initiative to make some software engineering in the university. And I said, this is an opportunity. I will take both way of thinking and put them in one degree. And it works very well. I think that they get the idea of how to think from this both fields. Another thing that I wanted to tell you is that I think that you must keep in mind when you educate students about innovations. So if you take some very good student that work very hard, he just have in his imagination working in some big company, IBM, Microsoft, and so on. And this is part of the education of doing everything technical and good, but with no other open-minded looking at the entire thing and see the opportunities. So having some course in the degree in which you just have to build your own startup and be examined on this, so it's everything on paper. But still, this possibility comes to mind. And if it comes to mind, then later you know that this is an option and maybe you use it. And it's very, very important, and we do it now in computer science. And there is another thing that we should be aware of, that if we educate some student, we have to also give tasks out of the blue to these students, and they have to find the information in the, say, in the internet, and really get deep into the details and techniques and make something out of it. Because this is what will happen most of their life. Now, if you ask somebody to be an expert on something, you should, he should be able to just dig into the, you know, huge information and way how to do some technical stuff that exists there outside, and use some links to friends and so on to get something that is done. I think this fashion was not there a few years ago. And now if you ask me to make some cheesecake, fine. It will be here in 1 hour. I know everything how to do it. So this is something that they also should have, these capabilities of finding their way in the huge information and finding the relevant information and doing it, understanding it, and having it on the fly. So this is my beliefs on the future education and how to make science and engineering together. Thank you.
תודה רבה. And the last speaker for this panel is Professor Tzvi Meiri. I already introduced him, but Tzvi is here. I need to apologize because we know each other for many years. At one point it slipped my mind. So please, Tzvi.
Thank you. Okay, before I go into the subject matter, I want to refer to two things that were mentioned by the former speakers. We're trying to define excellence and to define innovation. I don't know how to define excellence, but I know one when I see one. That's the best definition. As for innovation, I have something better. There is a book by Arthur Koestler, The Act of Creation. Who read it? Okay. Over there, he shows, he claims that the creativity is very akin to humor. When you tell a joke, why do people laugh? Go this way, and then all of a sudden you have this turn. Something unexpected. That's exactly the creative process. And he has a very thick book where he gives examples all over the history, etc. But that's creativity, aka innovation. Again, when we talk about innovation, engineering and science, it's doing something which is not obvious. That's from the patent law. By the way, the patent law does not, you do not need to show, and I think that Jonathan has shown examples, that your invention is useful. There is no such necessity. Other things, I think that Jonathan has covered this very, very well. And, but that's beside the point. Now, about the subject matter. My theme rotates around the question of science versus engineering. It has been alluded to by the other speakers. I'll propose a somewhat different approach, somewhat different. I want to start by saying that I myself, I am both an engineer and scientist. I did science, I did mostly engineering. So I can speak from both ends. I'm not going to speak about what I'm doing today, teaching in the engineering college. First of all, I just started. I did a lot of teaching at the Technion as an adjunct teacher, at the same time or contemporaneously with being in industry. I have taught courses. I have had about 20 graduate students during this year's PhDs, masters. And then in the last 10 years, I am supervising the final project, final projects of the Technion program for Master of Engineering in Systems Engineering. I'll talk about system engineering in a few moments. And I got my PhD from a small university in Berkeley. I had the opportunity of studying under one of the most prominent probabilist and mathematicians, Michel Loew. And I've spent a year at Bell Laboratories doing research, nothing practical, research. And I did research with my students. I did research at, later on at the IBM Research Center in Haifa. So I have lived in both worlds. So I allow myself, I permit myself to speak about the two. Now, what is the major difference between science and engineering? Science is basically analytic. Engineering is basically synthesis. An engineer synthesizes. Okay, being from the practical point of view, I don't care whether you solve your problems using scientific methods or black magic, as long as you solve it, as you get results. It's not solving the problems like Hagita's, it's not solving a problem. It's generating a system that has to satisfy the requirements, the needs, sorry, before the requirements. Requirements is technical. Need, the actual need. As was mentioned, I think, this morning by an example of the, I think Menachem Weiss said it, of the isothermal coffee cup. Okay, it failed because what the inventor wanted, he wanted to enjoy his coffee. The need was enjoying the coffee. And not necessarily doing it this way or that way. So you have to satisfy the need, you have to translate the need into requirements. That's systems engineering, that's part of system engineering. Identify the need, translate it into requirements, into things that you can measure, that you can quantify, and then go on solving the problem. Now, sometimes, within the engineering process, you sometimes need to do a little science. If you tackle something where there is no solution around for a subsystem or something, you have to do the research in many cases. I mentioned my professor at Berkeley, Michel Loew. I came to study in Berkeley after have already been an engineer, including some technical management position in Rafael for 6 years, and then I went to Berkeley. And he liked me very much. He said, oh, you should come and talk to my students, he said. These students know how to solve problems that somebody else has defined. They don't know how to define problems. They are A students. They are doing excellent job. But it takes them 4 years to find a topic for their PhD studies. They don't know how to do it. They are not synthesizing. And he said, you know, science is not always pure in the sense that you do something that nobody needs, nobody wants. In parentheses, you know that in the British Mathematical Society, they used to toast in the yearly convention, we hope that nobody will ever be able to use anything that we do today. Okay, but he said, look, also basic research, pure research, is also target-oriented. But you start to go towards your target, then you find there is something more interesting. You go this way, that way, that way, that way. After many, many rounds, you get to the target. Whereas applied research is very targeted. Engineering is really targeted. So sometimes you have to do some science. So I'm talking now about engineering is synthesizing approach. And the most important thing is the culture and the spirit. And now I come to the issue that Gadi has raised of the difference between colleges and universities. And I will talk about the situation here and now in the country. I want to, first of all, to have a disclaimer. What I'm going to say, maybe I'm going to say to exaggerate some things, are my personal ideas, my personal thinking. I do not in any way represent the college that I am now associated with. What I think is the raison d'etre of the colleges, especially the engineering colleges, I don't want to talk about other things, is that you want to educate engineers, people that will be able to synthesize, not necessarily to analyze only. While the research universities, according to the current practice by the MALAG, by the Council for Higher Education, their main goal is doing research. Yes, unfortunately, they also have to educate students, but that's, you know, that's a burden. It's not the main things. Now, this has been, if you remember that the MALAG consists mostly of professors of universities, they want to keep this. And the college program, the colleges, started first as it was called BTEC. Was something that the universities has strongly opposed. They didn't want this to happen. Pardon? They called it BTEC. Now, at the moment that it was decided that they will also give the title, the academic degree of Bachelor of Science, then the MALAG said, you want it this way? Fine. Then we want your program to be exactly as in the universities. We want to promote your staff by the same standards, number of publications. This is not what we need in colleges. In colleges, what we need is mostly people that come with experience of being engineers themselves, preferably excellent engineers. Yes, they should have, maybe like myself, they should also have had a bout with science or should be associated with science. But they don't publish. They don't publish. They give results. I personally have received 2 Israel Defense Prizes for developing missile systems, Popeye system and another one called Tadmit, which played dominant role for the Israeli Air Force. Now, they were not devoid of a scientific methodology, but these are engineering. Now, when I try to recruit new staff for the college today, I have a problem. When I try to recruit younger people, which for them, they have to develop their career, how can they get promoted unless they publish? How do they publish? If by the MALAG standards, a teacher in college has to have many more frontal hours. So on one hand, they want the academic standards of universities. I say academic standards and I put it in quotation marks. On the other hand, they underpay them, they don't give them the right salary, and they look at them as second-class citizens. I think this is wrong. It's completely wrong. How do we intend to solve this problem in our college? We tell every young faculty member, and they say young, for example, I have the first faculty member that I have recruited has a PhD from Technion. He has been teaching at the Technion as an adjunct for quite a few years, but also had a very interesting career in industry. And he said, you know, now I'm at an age that I want to do something else. I want to contribute to education. Now, how can he get promoted? So what we wanted from them is we wanted from them to keep affiliation with research universities, to be able to work the part-time, to have the graduate students, which is on one hand good for their own, for making them better, but on the other hand they need it, because otherwise they will stay where they are, and we will not be able to attract people like that. So there is a problem here. Now, going back to the question of excellence, I think that an excellent engineer does not necessarily need to be an excellent scientist. You require different things from him. What you want him to be is to be able to do his job, engineering job. So how is this going to be reflected in the way that we educate our students? Yes, we have a problem, because the way that the Malag has structured it, they require lower psychometric entry level. By the way, I think the psychometric test is not necessarily the right predictor for success, but we have to live with it. But what we want from them, we want that they will be excellent engineers, that they will do the best that they can do. And our approach is that if a student has difficulties, if he was in research university, they would kick him out after a semester or a year. What we want to do is we want to give him the crutches, not to let him pass through like that, but we want to give him crutches to raise him, to support him. That's the approach. I think that this is the approach of most colleges. They keep they are student-centric rather than teacher-centric. If you go to the Technion, for example, I know Technion very well, the Technion is teacher-centric. Okay, again, as I say, I'm going to exaggerate a little just to make the point. So excellence, excellent engineers, is a question of state of mind, more than just putting more and more pressure and feeding him with more and more information. I think that the two type of institutions should work side by side, should be able to collaborate in many ways. And I think that what the curve that Hagit has shown, that the number of students today in colleges is almost the same as the number in universities, I think this is a good sign, good sign. The colleges also have another task. It has nothing to do with excellence. And this is to be able to bring the education closer to the students, okay? So that they don't have to travel across half the country in order to get educated. And this is very important. Today in our program, we have started the first year, it's the first year, we've started only with evening program this year. We have about 20 students that come, that work. They come a couple of evenings and Fridays. They also have to come through a summer semester, and altogether it's spread over 5 years rather than 4 years. And I have one student that comes all the way from the north. He said, this is the only place where I can have an evening school. But I have been not so surprised or astonished, I don't know, both, to find that these students are really good, are really good. Anyway, one thing that I think that Hagit has alluded to, finding the best solution versus the sufficient. as an engineer, and not all engineers, even good engineers, know how to do that. This has to do with marketing. It does not have to do with engineering. Trying to strive always for the best solution, the best is the enemy of the good. So I've worked for several years as vice president of Elsint, when Elsint was still a medical equipment company. Today it's a real estate and hotels, after Motizisa bought it. There was a problem there. People always wanted to build the best MRI. And it took them a couple of years to get to market. They were late in getting to market. Rather than say, okay, let's see what we need to go to market, do whatever we can do to achieve this. If we can do better than our specs, fine. Otherwise, leave everything for the next generation or for the next upgrade. That's practical, a practical issue. Not necessarily has to do with engineering per se. It's beyond engineering. It's management and marketing. So it's not the best versus sufficient. Always do the best, but define the best. Defining the best from the point of view that I did is time in the market, define desired time to market as part of the system specification. This is when I want it to be in the market. If I don't do it, I have missed the point. Anyway, I think that I have covered what I wanted to say. Of course, I could speak here for a couple of hours more, but I've given you the essence.
Thank you.
I think we have a few minutes for discussion, so if anyone in the audience wants to ask, to remark, to make comments, that's the time. If not, Sofa Kenes, you want to say something, Norma? Toda rabba. Toda rabba to you. Toda rabba to the panel members. Thank you.